Good morning, I am Dr. Janasri, working in St. Peter's Engineering College, taking classes for first year students in environmental science. Last class we have discussed in this first unit ecosystem classification. We have seen the different types of ecosystems in our world, different types of natural ecosystems. Today we will discuss about structural and functional components of ecosystem. Ecosystem structural components, they can be broadly classified as abiotic and biotic. Abiotic means non-living, without any life, and where the living organisms has to interact with non-living. And biotic also, there are diversified biotic organisms or biotic species in this ecosystem. We can take example of abiotic as air, sunlight, water, soil, temperature, etc. And biotic components like plants, animals, microorganisms, what we see here. The biotic components are further again classified as producers, consumers, and decomposers. Best example for producers, plant, and decomposers, fungi or bacteria. Consumers can again further be classified as herbivores, carnivores, omnivores based upon their food habits. For all this life to exist, we have to depend on sunlight. Plants prepare their food utilized in the presence of sunlight, and these herbivores are dependent on these plants. They are providing food for herbivores, carnivores, and many other. Like that, the plant, animals are dependent on non-living components, and also they are interacting themselves. After the death, again, they are getting decomposed, plants and animals. Now we will see what are the biotic components, which are living organisms in ecosystem. They can be further classified as producers, consumers, and decomposers. Producers means mostly green plants. They can synthesize their food by themselves using carbon dioxide and water in presence of sunlight by involving chlorophyll through the process called photosynthesis, and they are also called photoautotrophs. As they are preparing their own food, autumn is by themselves. Trophos is a Greek word taken meaning nourishment. Photo means in presence of sunlight, so called photoautotrophs. Best example, green plants. Some microorganisms can synthesize organic matter through oxidation of certain chemicals in absence of sunlight. They are known as chemoautotrophs. In absence of sunlight, by chemical synthesis, they are preparing so-called chemoautotrophs. Examples, sulfur bacteria in ocean. Nitrogen fixing bacteria also as an example we can take for this chemoautotrophs. Next class, consumers. Consumers can be further classified based upon their food habits. Herbivores. The herbivores, they consume only plant or plant products as their food. You can take any herbivore example, cow, goat, etc. Carnivores, which consumes only flesh as their food, tiger, lion, etc. Omnivores, which consume either plant or plant products or flesh as their food, like crow, hen, etc. Detritivores, which consume dead organic matter as their food, earthworm, termites, etc. Decomposers, which converts the dead organic complex matter into simpler form. After the death of plant and animals, they are converting the dead organic matter into simpler forms, example, bacteria, fungi, etc. Functional components of ecosystem. The major functional attributes of an ecosystem are food chain, food web, energy flow, biogeochemical cycles. These things we are here in this class we will discuss one by one. First one, food chain. Food chain is nothing but the sequence of eating and being eaten in an ecosystem is called a food chain. Food chains are of two types, grazing food chain, which is more predominant in this world, and detritus food chain. This grazing food chain starts with a green plant and is dependent on sunlight, and it continues like starting with green plant next to herbivores, carnivores, and carnivores like that. But a detritus food chain starts with dead organic matter. Any fallen leaf can become a food for any carnivore, detritivore, because here the detritus is the starting of this food chain. The organisms which depend on this detritus is called detritivore. So it starts with a dead organic matter which is consumed by detritivores, and it continues. The end point of these two food chains is similar, but the starting is different. It starts with the green plant, depends on sunlight. It starts with dead organic matter, does not depend on sunlight. This is one of the best example of grazing food chain, where the producers, primary consumers, secondary consumer, tertiary consumers, after the death they are getting decomposed. Example of detritus food chain. This detritus is consumed by detritivores, then these are taken by primary consumers, secondary consumers and tertiary consumers. You can see the difference here. It starts with a green plant, it starts with a fallen leaf, but the end both are same, starting are different. Here it depends on sunlight, here does not depend on sunlight, as it starts with that organic matter. The next functional component, food web. Food web is a network of food chains where different types of organisms are connected at different trophic levels, so that there are a number of options of eating and being eaten at each trophic level. Here if you see, a rabbit, it can eat either a grass of this type or another one, or a lizard can have this grasshopper or some other insect. Best example we can see here in this slide. In a grassland ecosystem, the rabbit, depending on plant, but this rabbit can become food as a food by the fox or a hawk. Same way squirrel, this can be swallowed by or taken by a fox or hawk or some other animal like a snake. At each level they are having alternate food habits, so it appears like a interconnections between the food chains. The basic difference between food chain and food web, here you can see it is a sequence, like here you can see interconnections between the food chains. The next functional component is energy flow. The energy flow is the amount of energy that moves along the food chain. Energy flows through an ecosystem in only one direction. It is unidirectional. The energy flow in the ecosystem is important to maintain an ecological balance. The producers synthesize food by the process of photosynthesis. A part of the energy is stored within the plant. The remaining energy is utilized by the plant in their growth, development and other respiration and other activities. This stored energy is transferred to the primary consumers when they feed on the producers. The energy is further passed on to the secondary consumers and when they feed on the primary consumers, and so on. Here we can see in this picture how the energy flow, sunlight, and here the producers, whatever it is storing, is passed to the primary consumers, next to the secondary consumer. Part of the energy is utilized by them for their different metabolic activities, and part is wasted for detritivores or decomposers. In each and every trophic level we can see the same thing. Energy is unidirectional. As we move from one trophic level to another trophic level, energy is getting reduced. This was best explained by thermodynamics laws. Next functional component is ecological pyramids. Ecological pyramid is nothing but a graphical representation of trophic structure and functioning of ecosystem, starting with the producers at the base and successive trophic levels forming the apex. There are three different types of ecological pyramids. There are three different types of ecological pyramids: pyramid of number, pyramid of biomass, pyramid of energy. First one, pyramid of number. Pyramid of number is the graphical representation of relationship between the number of species at each trophic level. Placing the producers at the base, we may get an upright pyramid or inverted pyramid based upon the type of the ecosystem. What we take as an example, Here in this picture we can see example of a grassland ecosystem and a pond ecosystem. Grassland because producers are placed at the base, so grasses are placed at the base here in the grassland ecosystem. Here also phytoplankton placed at the base. The next levels, successive trophic levels above it, as the number of species present at the trophic levels are reducing, you can see here pyramid is upright or erect. In this case also, compared to the phytoplankton, zooplankton, other carnivores are reducing, so the pyramid is upright here. Here we can see the explanation for grassland. Here a number of grasses, grass plants at producer level are more, and then compared to the number of rats, number of snakes, peacocks at their respective trophic levels. So here we got the graphical representation pyramid of number upright. Coming to the pyramid of biomass. Pyramid of biomass is the graphical representation of relationship between the biomass of species at each trophic level, placing the producers at the base. The pyramid can be upright or inverted based upon the ecosystem. If you take an example of forest ecosystem, dry or fresh weight of the plant at producer level, the biomass of herbivores and biomass of carnivores and biomass of higher carnivores at their respective trophic levels, and when we represent them graphically, it will be upright pyramid only. The representation you can see, it is upright pyramid when we consider at the animals at each trophic level. Next comes, here is one example of pyramid of biomass of aquatic ecosystem. In an aquatic ecosystem, producers, though they are plenty, their mass is negligible. Here we got a small bar. Compared to the zooplankton, their mass is negligible. But here, compared to the next carnivore, their zooplankton mass is less. So the pyramid is inverted. In an aquatic ecosystem, we can see the pyramid is inverted. Pyramid of biomass is inverted. Coming to the last pyramid, ecological pyramid, pyramid of energy. Pyramid of energy is the graphical representation of relationship between the energy of species at each trophic level, placing the producers at the base and successive trophic levels above it. In all ecosystems, pyramid of energy will be upright. As we move from one trophic level to another, placing the producers at the base, energy is getting reduced, as we have discussed in energy flow. Energy is getting reduced as we move from one trophic level to another trophic level. So in all types of ecosystems, pyramid of energy will be upright. Here we can see one small example of grassland ecosystem. The pyramid of energy in a producer, we can find here 1000 kilocalories of energy. When after it gets stored, when it is taken by as food by the next primary consumer, the energy it is entering into the next level will be 100 kilocalories only. The next one, after the energy utilized by this grasshopper for its metabolic activities, whatever stored energy will be there in these animals or these primary consumers, this will be entering to the next level. Only 10%, you can see, it is entering into the next level. In secondary consumer, it will be only 10 kilocalories. Like that, only 10% is entering into the next level. In tertiary consumers, only 1 kilocalorie. We can see here reduction of energy as we move from one trophic level to another trophic level. This is also example. Next, coming to the functional component, biogeochemical cycles. Biogeochemical cycles, here in our syllabus we are having basically water cycle, carbon cycle, nitrogen cycle, and phosphorus and potassium cycle. Energy flows matter cycles. Here carbon, nitrogen, phosphorus, water. First we will see water cycle, what it is there. Water cycle, the basic steps in water cycle are evaporation and transpiration from the plants. The whatever is evaporated, it gets condensed and precipitated in various places. If it is a land, it gets percolated into the soil, recharges the aquifers. And if it is a water body, it again gets evaporated in a cyclic manner. The water cycle you can see here totally. The next one is carbon cycle. carbon cycle. The carbon dioxide found in the atmosphere is taken by the plants, utilized during photosynthesis, and this gets assimilated in various forms like carbohydrates and other things. They are utilized by the animals, and in turn the plant releases during photosynthesis oxygen, that is again dependent, that oxygen is taken by the animals. But coming to the carbon dioxide only, whatever is taken as food, that means carbohydrate under this carbon which is fixed by the plants in various forms, this is becoming organic matter for the animals. They are again utilizing that as food, and after the death of this plant and animal, they are getting decomposed by the decomposers like bacteria and other things, and again they are releasing out carbon dioxide into the atmosphere. Sometimes the dead organic matter, after thousands of years, when they got deep buried into the soil due to temperature and pressure, high temperature and pressure, converted into fossil fuels. That fossil fuels, when we are extracting by combustion of these fossil fuels in automobiles or industries, they are releasing again CO2 back in the form of carbon monoxide or CO2. So it is a total cyclic form where the carbon is moving from atmosphere into living organisms back to the atmosphere. Next cycle is nitrogen cycle. Nitrogen cycle, we can see nitrogen, the major 78% of atmosphere contains nitrogen. Though it is found in gaseous form, plants cannot take this in the form of gaseous form like CO2. It has to be converted into nitrate form. Then only through root uptake they can take this nitrogen and utilizes or assimilates in the form of amino acids or proteins in their body. So two, three types we can have this nitrogen fixation. Physical type, that means without utilization of any living organisms, during lightning and thunder it is fixed in the form of ammonia and later in the form of nitrites and nitrates. Or else sometimes we can see the living organisms like bacteria, they fixes the atmospheric nitrogen in the form of nitrate and nitrate. Here leguminous plants, you can see here leguminous plants contains rhizobium bacteria. It is a symbiotic bacteria, have an ability to fix the atmospheric nitrogen, and this atmospheric nitrogen is fixed by these rhizobium bacteria in the form of nitrate, and these nitrates are utilized by the plants, and from the plants they are entering into the animal and through food. And after the death of these plants and animals, they are entering into detritivores or decomposers and releases again back ammonia, and this ammonia is again converted by some microorganisms into, like bacteria only, into nitrites and nitrates. So this nitrogen is also a cyclic form and starts from an atmospheric nitrogen, fixes in the form of nitrates, utilizes by the plants, entering into animal, again entering back into the atmosphere. Some denitrifying bacteria are there which can convert the nitrate into nitrogen. So it's a total cyclic form. A phosphorus cycle. Phosphorus is a sedimentary cycle. Phosphorus mostly found in phosphate rocks by withering or normal by utilization of phosphorus. By some industries also we can have this phosphorus to the plants. Naturally phosphorus is available to the plants in the soil through root uptake. They take this phosphorus, assimilates in the body, and through food it enters into animal. After the death of the plant and animal, we can see decomposers are decomposing, and again it is reaching the soil. Excess of phosphorus, when we are using, they are getting sedimented in the water bodies, and this phosphate rich water, when it is taken by some of the marine birds, or that means when they are consuming marine fish as their food, these birds, when they release their excreta on the soil, they again the phosphorus is coming out as guano deposits on the soil in Peru region it was identified. So the phosphorus also in various forms we can use. We are using this phosphorus in toothpaste, and this also is entering into the drainage and it reaching the water bodies. So these are the various stages, types of phosphorus entering into the plant, animal, again by decomposition adding to the soil, from the soil again back to the soil, the cyclic process of phosphorus. Next comes the potassium cycle. Potassium major reservoir is mineral form. 90% we can see potassium is available, and about only a non-exchangeable form 1 to 10%, exchangeable form 1 to 2%. This potassium get dissolved in the soil solution through root uptake, they enters into the plant, and during harvesting the fallen twigs again decomposes and it is reaching the soil. When the plant it gets assimilating this potassium through food, it enters into the animal body. After the death of the plant and animal, it enters into the soil again back by decomposition. Here also we can see the picture where the potassium, how it is entering into the plant through soil solution. Mineral maximum, next to fixed type and exchangeable form. So it entering into the soil through root uptake, it enters into the plant body. So potassium cycle from the soil through the plant animal and again reaching the soil. This is also a cyclic process. So with this we have completed biogeochemical cycles. The next one is biomagnification or bioaccumulation. Bioaccumulation means it is increase in the concentration of non-biodegradable substance, we can say as a pollutant, in an organism body. When it is getting accumulated in one organism body, this type of non-biodegradable substance, it is called bioaccumulation. What are these non-biodegradable substances? They can be some types of pesticides, example insecticide DDT, or some endrin which was banned, and some heavy metals. They show affinity towards the fatty acids in the body and gets accumulated in one organism body. And if such type of non-biodegradable substance is found increased in concentration in a food chain, then it is called biomagnification. So as we move from one trophic level to another trophic level, if the concentration of these non-biodegradable substances is increasing, then it is called biomagnification. Here in this picture also we can see biomagnification, this increasing in a food chain as we move from one trophic level to another trophic level. The highest carnivore has maximum concentration of this type of pollutant. And here in bioaccumulation, one organism we have identified in very less concentration. The same organism, if it is consuming the pollutant or polluted, the plant species which contains this type of DDT, same type of plants in the same water body, this organism is consuming for many times, then it gets accumulated in their body, and this accumulation of non-biodegradable substance in one species or one organism body is called bioaccumulation. If it is increasing in a food chain, it is called biomagnification. Okay, today we have discussed structural components of ecosystem, functional components of an ecosystem, food chain, food web, energy flow, ecological pyramids, biogeochemical cycles, and biomagnification and bioaccumulation. Thank you.